All right, welcome on into the Falls Gone Anywhere podcast. Charlie, John, and Chris all here with you as per usual. We are here on Facebook Live. So if anybody wants to chime in while we're doing our friendly show here, go ahead and feel free to do so. Here on May the 18th of 2024, guys.
Stone Cold ET, and I want a couple of cheeseburgers, and that's the bomb line.
What the hell is that? Oh no!
Like to come to White Castle or a couple of cheeseburgers to fill me up before I whoop some ass. Give me a hell if you're down with Stone Cold ET.
What the? Wow!
Stone Cold ET. Oh hell yeah!
Oh wow!
That was awesome. Well, at least they're getting creative. I love it. So, I mean, I shouldn't say that because I'm encouraging that shit.
Somebody just asked me yesterday, have we been hacked? And I said, no, it's been good.
Yeah, we've been hacked. That's freaking hilarious. Anyway, it's episode number 123 here at Falls Gone Anywhere. And anything can happen as we go live, as we just found out. So let's get the ball rolling here, guys. Just trying to... Stone Cold ET, is that a real thing? Anyway, let's get the ball rolling here, guys. Go ahead, Chris.
All right. Well, this is our monthly classic show. And first, we'd like to welcome our guest, a man who's been in the business and a great another historian from the state of Massachusetts, Mr. Tom Burke.
Thank you. Welcome. Thank you for having me on. It's a great privilege.
Thank you, sir.
Pleasure to have you, Tom. Thanks for joining us.
Second,
my pleasure.
Friend with a wealth of wrestling knowledge throughout the years from Maryland, Mr. Todd Fisher.
Hey guys, how are you? Thanks for
hey,
having
Todd.
Me.
Todd. Welcome
hey,
back.
Todd.
I thought the Alex Wright one was good, but that might take the cake.
All he wanted was a couple cheeseburgers.
We're going to have to see that guy. Whoever's doing that, we're going to have to see his stand-up act at some point.
And... last but not least, a historian of not just the AWA, but all the territories, our good friend from the state of Minnesota, Mr. George Shire.
Good morning, guys.
Welcome back, George.
George, how are you?
I'm great. Always good to be on with Tom Burke. Boy, we don't see enough of each other. And Todd, great to meet you.
You got that right.
And then the other three stooges above.
George, we're a tag team.
That's right.
All right, well, guys, you know how this goes. We show a couple clips, we discuss it, and we go on. So, John, if you will, please roll clip number one.
Wrong one. Hold on. Wrong one.
That's okay. Some classic Big John Studd here.
Jeez. You know, Stud was no small guy, obviously. And you look at Andre, it's like, my goodness.
No, it's crazy. He only weighed 335.
But he looked huge, yeah.
Yeah.
Considering, I think, of today's football players and stuff.
And he goes right to work on the Mad Dog. I always like watching classic Big John Studd here myself. St. Louis.
That's when he was broke. Oh, you had a title on, though.
Yeah, he was only DBS.
Yeah, DiBiase.
I don't know. Yeah, go back and watch DiBiase before he was the Million Dollar Man. Actually, a great wrestler.
Oh, I remember. This is
this tag team.
That's Scott Irwin with him, I believe.
You are right.
This is
Super
good.
Destroyer. And then Mid-South. At 339 pounds from Los Angeles, California, Big John Studd. And his partner at 308. The refereeing went on, and of course, you can see it ring All right, well, that goes into our second clip there, but our first clip.
There he is, guys.
Yep, there
he is. I saw the LJN sitting on the desk here.
Well, before we get into Big John Studd, we want to send a shout out to our friend, Mr. Herb Simmons, and their Fan Fest 2 going on last night and today there in St. Louis area. So a shout out to them. Hopefully they have a good Fan Fest.
Man, they have a packed show for that. It's crazy. It's like 60 guys there that are going to be showing up, the legends. It's going to be awesome. Anyway, yeah. Sorry, Chris, go ahead.
And Todd, why don't you start us off? Tell George and Mr. Burke about a little history of Big John Studd.
So I'm in the Maryland area, and my father, Big John Studd lived in Virginia, and my father was basically Big John Studd's agent for several years as a wrestler. We became very close with him. The one time I went to his house, he had been to my house a bunch of times. The one time I went to his house, and it was weird to see Andrea with hair, because the one time I went to Stud's house, he had Andre's hair. That was right after he had cut Andre's hair, and I was sitting there playing with his hair, but with Andre's hair in a bag, not realizing how crazy that was, and robe collection and everything like that. But when I say Gentle Giant, there's one thing about Big John Studd, and my dad did a lot of projects with him. One of them was the Jerry Lewis telethon that my dad was actually with Big John Studd on the stage. And those were back in the days where, with kayfabe and everything like that. And Big John Studd basically said, I'm breaking I'm breaking the wall for this, because this is for kids and this is charity. And I mean, he was one of the hottest, bad guys back then. That was in prime, and he's on the stage and they were giving off, the famous, I know John and Chris, I know you guys remember the famous wrestling dolls, the original ones where they had the Iron Sheik, Junkyard Dog, Bundy, Hogan. They were giving all those out to kids. And, and it just shows you how, back then that, you could put, your character aside to, do something for charity. And then, way back in the day when, as you remember, Studd was doing the $15,000 slam challenge. I'm sure. And my dad set this up with Studd and a local DJ here in Washington, D.C. His name was the Grease Man, who was very, very popular. He was basically the Howard Stern of the Maryland, D.C., Virginia area. And he was actually ahead of Howard Stern within the ratings when he was when Howard was in D.C. My dad set this up, this Grease Man, for the Grease Man to try to attempt to slam Big John Studd at the Capitol Center, and it sold the whole show out. And obviously he didn't slam him, but they set that up. My dad was actually calling the match, calling the action for DC 101 that night as well. I just wish I had that tape. I can't find it anywhere, but
wow, yeah,
talking off the air about some of the memorabilia and where it goes and how you lose it, that's one I wish had. And there's a bunch of stuff I wish I had. My mom threw my whole wrestling magazine collection away when I had the Wrestler, the PWI, all of them every month for like 10 years. So a good fire somewhere. But yeah, I can't say enough about Big John Studd and what a great guy he was and a true legend. And your clips, Chris, that's before the day I really started. Before I was probably even born, knew who he was. So it's cool to see, him in that, much kind of thinner then too, in some of the early clips. But that's what I think separates your show, is that you have those clips and it brings back a lot of memories and, a lot for me to learn as well from the history of some of these guys. So,
well, George, some classic AWA footage of Big John.
Yeah, that was good. When you saw him in the ring there against Mad Dog Vachon, they met a few times here. And, of course, you talk about a Mutt and Jeff scenario. Mad Dog is like this much shorter. And one of the things that was really good about that is this was during Mad Dog's babyface days. But I remember when you talk about making it real, and letting fans suspend that disbelief, Studd used to use the heart punch. And on Mad Dog and Baron Von Raschke, he would put that punch in the heart area. And there were actually times when you'd see like the ripple, like the fist. Well, it looks like it just went in, and it was so real. And of course, you know they protected each other, but it was phenomenal with the dog and the Baron, how that looked so real. And when he would put it in there, and like the guys would just stop. Very believable hold in the time. Tom, you might remember this. I think you were at the 76 Dallas WFIA, and Stuck.
Yes, I was.
He was working there under a mask as Captain USA.
Right, he was. Yeah. He came in. He was a protege of Killer Kowalski's.
Yes.
Kowalski met him in L.A. when Walter was running for LaBelle, working for LaBelle, and they hooked up and they really gelled. And he came into WWE or WWF at the time as the Executioner. I remember one time after a show they were on, and we all went out to eat at a Chinese buffet place for Kowalski. But fond memories. He was a good guy. I really enjoyed him. He was unlike his character, like so many of the guys.
Oh.
He was a baby face in real life and not a heel.
Right.
With when you say Killer Kowalski, I remember sitting when I was on the board of directors with CAC, and I had the opportunity to sit next to Killer Kowalski at the big table. And what a gentle giant. And then he and I had a chance to talk, and he took a napkin, and I hate myself for not picking it up, but he had a napkin on the table, and he was hand drawing, and he drew like a caricature, and he got up and we got done. We left. And afterwards I went, oh, I should have taken that thing.
That's funny, George.
But he was good. And I will tell you, when you mentioned a Chinese place for Kowalski, he was always a vegetarian. And when he was in the AWA in 1967, he had a program against the Crusher, who was one of our top baby faces. And Crusher used to come to the ringside on the TV matches when Killer was in the ring. And the Crusher would have a big bag of lettuce and carrots and throwing him in the ring at Kowalski while he was wrestling. And of course, Killer's, putting it over and selling it like, this maniac. It was funny as hell.
George, I thought you were going to go with, I thought maybe he was going to come in with a raw steak around his neck or something. I thought that's where you're going with that. But
Crusher used to throw vegetables at him. But I mean, it was like a head of lettuce and carrots. And then the Crusher did the same thing when he wrestled against Mad Dog in those days. And the Crusher would come out with a big bag of dog food, and he'd be throwing dog food in the ring on the TV show. Anything to irritate the opponent. Yeah.
Tom,
that's right. I'd like to point something out on the video that was just presented. And that was the entrance of the guys in the ring.
Yes.
Stud with the long robe, DiBiase with a jacket. It was a real throwback as how wrestlers looked and presented themselves before the matches. Today, if on the indie circuit, the guys come in, they don't dress like that. They all have tats up and down. It's just not the same at all. And it currently, they emulate what they see in WWE or other groups. There's hardly any wrestling holds.
No, it's all acrobats these days. It's a lot of high-flying, high-risk spots. And I'm with you there, Tom. I think it's the old school. I mean, I shouldn't even call it old school, but just traditional wrestling. It's there in spots. But, everybody's trying to do – what it is? I feel like it all emulated from when ECW converted over to WWE and they started doing the tables and chairs matches, which are fun. Don't get me wrong. I love those matches. But not every match has to be that way.
Right.
Exactly.
And I think today they don't need to pretend that it's real because they've let the rabbit out of the hat. But going back to that time, when the guys would come to the ring with their ring jackets and the title belts, and they'd be presented as a real contest. You believe that it was real. They came down the aisle in a dark auditorium. just the lights above the ring were on. The auditorium wasn't lit up like a Christmas tree, and you didn't have all the pyrotechnics going off. Right. You know, 'cause that's more of the show today. But you know what, guys? It works for the generation. So I guess, you know, old fogies like Tom and I, we have to just accept it, and we enjoy our memories. I always say, give me more of the past so I can enjoy the present.
Go ahead, God.
Absolutely, George.
One last stud story I wanted to share with you guys. You guys always, I see with your guests, you're always asking about Andre stories. So a stud Andre story.
Yeah.
My dad tells me, he said, Big John just called me. He was literally in tears over the phone, and he was hysterical because he had accidentally knocked Andre the Giant out with a chair. Andre moved one way, supposed to go the other. And when you say people are scared to death of Andre the Giant, Stud was fits into that category just as much. He said if Andre was in a bad mood, his life was miserable. But when he knocked him out, that he got into the backstage and got the hell out of the arena before Andre could find him.
I've heard something like that before, Todd, where literally there was a point where Stud was running from the ring, and they said, "Where are you going?" He said, "He's pissed. I'm getting out of here." For as Big John Stud was, it's unbelievable with the presence of Andre. I mean, wow.
Yeah, that's crazy. You heard that as well. I don't know if it was the same match, or you know, maybe it happened.
It was on one of those documentaries I caught, whether it was on Andre himself or if it was on Big John Studd. That story was told by somebody. It was like, wow, that's pretty wild.
Cool. Yeah, because my dad was like, I've never heard him like that before. He was really, really scared and upset.
Wow, that was our viewer, Jan Potting, there, saying a shout out to Todd Fisher.
Hey, Jan. Thanks for checking us out. And a shout out to Todd there. Todd, getting all the... pulling up our ratings here, buddy. Appreciate it.
Yeah.
I'm just fly on the wall.
He makes the same amount of money we do, though, right?
Right. Yeah. Right.
Yeah. All right. All right.
We try to distribute it evenly. You know what I mean?
I just to donate to Nikita Koloff's charity, and then we're good, you know?
There you go.
Yeah, there we go.
I worked in banking a lot of years, but I've never been able to divide zero by three.
Well, John, let's roll our second clip, if you will, please, sir. Here we go. Some classic clips of title for title matches. Obviously, here, the Super Bowl of Wrestling, 1978. That was Billy Graham and Harley Race. This is 8mm footage of the classic confrontation in 1980, Madison Square Garden, between Bob Backlund and Harley Race.
Wow.
Here, of course, we have the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, against the Puerto Rican champion, Carlos Colon. This one, you know, if you got to check this out, this one's on YouTube. Ric Flair versus Rick Martel from Japan, 1985. It is a classic. Now we go down to Portland, Oregon for this one against Billy Jack Haynes.
Maybe it's just because it is at the Coliseum. Maybe it is because there are
13,000 people all looking at it, huh?
Vintage
Flair
there.
Tell you what, tomorrow night then, at the Omni, it now stands the world. Love wrestling Harry too. Will be defending his title against the challenge of this man right here, the Georgia heavyweight champion, wrestling too. You people out there, I'll tell you this right now. Harley Race, you, sir, have gone down as low as any man has gone. Oh, 523-6880. Call that number, Chris. See if we can get some tickets for that.
I wish.
Yeah, last one was Harley Race against the Florida champion, Barry Windham. With some classic title for title matches there.
One of the things I always enjoyed about Mr. Wrestling, too, I think this is the story of a guy that totally was able to keep reinventing himself. And his final run as Mr. Wrestling 2 was probably his most remembered. But as Johnny Walker. He was a rubber man early in his career. And then he wrestled under other masks. He was the grappler at one point. He was, I think there was another one I can't recall right now, but he was a heel. And then when he hooked up in the Mr. Wrestling 2 thing, that's when it really took off for him. And my favorite story, you want to talk about kayfabe. My favorite story about Mr. Wrestling 2 was when they claimed that Miss Lillian, who was Jimmy Carter's mother, who was a huge wrestling fan, her favorite wrestler was Mr. Wrestling 2. So they invited him to the White House to meet her, but he wouldn't come because Secret Service said he had to remove his mask and he wasn't going to do it.
So wow.
Talk about carrying it to the limit.
I heard that story. Yes.
You know,
it didn't matter that
you showed a clip there.
20 years.
You showed a clip of Carlos Colon. He started up here for Tony Santos in 1965. And they billed him from Hawaii as Prince Koala. And he, you know, eventually, you know, transformed himself to his family name and did very well, you know. And, I remember him, I think I saw his third match. And he wrestled Ronnie Dupree from the, aka the Hells Angels here in, where was that, at Holyoke. But fond memories. He was out of the Santos troupe, which, of course, gave the world of wrestling many, many top stars.
My father did a lot of work, switching to Bob Backlund you showed there. My father did a lot of work with Backlund back in the day. And I had sent it to John like a couple of months ago or so. But I have a picture of Backlund at my house putting me in the chicken wing when I was like old. And, you know, he was champion. He was in his prime. And we had talked about some of the history. I have a cassette tape that I found of Bob Backlund on the local radio, keeping kayfabe the whole way, talking about this was right after he lost to the Iron Sheik and trying to get his belt back, which obviously he knew he was never going to see again. But I used to go to see Backlund at the Capitol Center from the age of 5 until basically and all the way through, you know, until Hogan took over. And when you go back and watch Backlund, it's amazing he was champion for 6 years. He was boring as hell. I mean, you really watch his matches. I mean, he would have a guy in an arm bar for 3 to 5 minutes. You could go to the bathroom and come back, and Backlund's still on the ground with the guy and with a leg lock. And you know, a lot of boring chants during Backlund matches when I was a kid.
Part of the thing with Backlund, though, and I agree, I never thought he was really exciting, but he goes back to that what was perceived as a real wrestler type thing. The main thing that brought him over, I think, was for 5 years that really the killer opponents that he always had. You know, it was always him playing the underdog babyface and having, you know, the Killer Khans and
yeah.
You know, whoever the heel was part of the whole show on that one.
And I was so young, but I remember Killer Khan, and I think maybe Blackjack Mulligan. He may have wrestled once when I was there too. But the exciting when I was a kid were Rocky Johnson and Tony Atlas and Rick Martel and Tony Gurria. You know, some of those guys were a lot better as baby faces, a lot more exciting than Backlund, who was champion. 6 years, which is still crazy. A nice guy. I mean, yeah. He was more than generous to me and my family. But
you saw Rick Martel in there against Flair briefly on one of those clips. And Rick Martel, I think of all of the champions of that era, I think he gets the less credit of all of them. He was such a talented worker. Yeah. And he could rough it up with the best heels. I mean, I saw his matches against Stan Hansen. Yeah. And, you know, they were just on fire. But Rick was very, very over with the fans. His interviews were a little bit less exciting. And then, of course, we know he went on to become the model, and that was a whole different era. But as a babyface, I think he was probably one of the best of those babyface champions.
You're just waiting for Gurria.
I agree with you, George.
You're just waiting for Gurria to tag Martel because Gurria was kind of a bore. But when he tagged Martel, it was dropkick, and the place would just go crazy.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Though, I mean, he doesn't get enough credit, I think. I've seen matches against him versus Kamala, a classic versus Jerry Lawler. Martel should definitely be in all the Hall of Fames.
Well, and I saw him wrestle against Bockwinkel a few times.
Yes.
And, you know, you talk about two classics there. And, I mean, Nick made – he could make anyone look better. But in this case, with Ric Flair, he didn't need – or with Rick Martel, he didn't need to. I mean, they just – they were good together. And I will add this. Rick Martel, he teamed here in AWA with Tito Santana. And they had a few matches around the horn with Greg Gagne and Jim Brunzell, babyface versus babyface tags. And I'm a tag team lover, guys. I love tag team matches. I always have. And these babyface matches were as good as you are ever going to get. There were no rest holds, but a lot of hold and counter hold and flips and flops and near pins and quick tags. And the matches, nobody yelled boring during them, I'll tell you that. I saw them wrestle twice. And very, very old.
I have those two matches, George, and yeah, I love them. They are classics indeed. Well, John, want to roll our third clip already? Here we got a classic promotion that went into the early 80s, owned by the Puffos out of Kentucky, ICW. Here we see the Big Cat, Ernie Ladd, against Crusher Broomfield. Now, as you will see shortly, Crusher Broomfield was actually, to us, known as the One Man Gang.
Oh.
Oh, here's a young savage. Here we go again. Here, Savage against Broomfield again, which was a One Man Gang later. I gotta love this old studio wrestling.
Oh man, yeah.
Here's a rare one of matches. Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert against Weeping Lanny Poffle. Ronnie Garvin against young Cowboy Bob Orton Jr. A steel cage match here, Charlie, with our friend Rip Rogers against Leap Manny.
Oh, nice. The unfiltered one, Rip Rogers. Absolutely. No mistaking that guy, the Big Ox.
The Big Ox.
I mean, that's just natural intimidation, the look on Ox Baker, man. And I always find it, I'm sure you guys have seen this, or if you haven't, please go YouTube it. The clip of him on The Price is Right is hysterical. Because it's like big bushy eyebrows and like this beard. It's like, look at this guy.
In that's hilarious. I'll give my sense real fast on the clip, Chris. The two of the people on there that I met Lenny Poffo backstage, and when Lenny Poffo was in the WWF, he would have handwritten poems in his hand, and he would throw them to the crowd, ball them up, and throw them to the crowd. And Lenny Poffo backstage was one of the, you know, totally different than his brother, was so nice. And we were young kids, and he would ask us, give me the name of a wrestler. And then we'd say Roddy Piper. And he would come up with this top poem for us. Like, he didn't have to do that. And he was such a smart guy and such a nice guy. And I wish, you know, memorabilia, I wish we kept those poems, you know, because he gave us a bunch of them. And Ronnie Garvin was champ. When Ronnie Garvin beat Ric Flair in the NWA, he was only champion for about 3 months or so. But I, during those 3 months, it was the first time I'd ever been to an NWA match. And that's when Ronnie Garvin was champion. And I met Ronnie Garvin backstage. He didn't have the belt on him. but I think I sent that to John. And I don't know if you guys are familiar with Gary Juster. Was a big promoter in the Baltimore area. My father,
he was from St. Paul here.
Is that right?
Yeah, Gary and I have been friends since the early 70s.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. Yeah,
I grew up in Golden Valley, Minnesota.
Yeah, that's awesome. My father was friends with him, and we started really getting more into NWA, WCW than the WWF. But Ronnie Garvin was champion. I met him, and I met Brad Armstrong that night. Those were the only two, but that was my first ever NWA match. And real quick, I'll say that when I was going to see Hulk Hogan, and even when I worked for WCW, guys like Goldberg, and I've seen The Rock and Stone Cold, the entrance music and the loudness and the crowd and everything. But my first ever NWA match in Baltimore, when the Road Warriors came out to Iron Man, I literally had to put my fingers over my ears. I've never seen a crowd that loud than the Road Warriors. And it was my first time ever seeing them and live. And it was amazing. So when people say, the Dudleys are the best tag, there's nobody close to the Road Warriors. I mean, the Dudleys aren't even better than the Steiners. But anyway, I digress. But great clips, Chris, and I'll be quiet.
I'm going to share an Ox Baker story with you. You know, he was kind of an unpredictable character at times. I took a road trip in 1970 to Oklahoma with Norman Keitzer. We drove down there together to deliver wrestling news magazines to Leroy McGurk and Cowboy Bill Watts. Watts was down there promoting. So after the matches, Baker was on the card. And after the matches, I was in the locker room, kind of a mouse, kind of keeping to myself. And in the locker room at the time was Rene Goulet, and Ox Baker came in. And then there were a couple of other wrestlers. Sputnik Monroe was over in the background. But here comes Ox Baker, and you talk about scaring the hell out of a 20-year-old kid. He scooped me up, I swear to God, had me like over his head, and he yells over to Goulet. He says, "What do you want me to do with this kid?" Goulet says, "Throw him in the shower." And he kind of went like this, you know, and I, oh my God. And then he put me down and gave me this big pat on the back of my shoulder, which the big old paw damn near knocked me out. And then he was laughing so hard. And that was my encounter with Ox Baker.
That's pretty funny. That's awesome.
That's great, George.
And Goulet says, "Throw him in the shower."
Did you have some nightmares after that, George, of like Ox Baker chasing you down a hallway and stuff? I mean, because that guy was scary, man.
Well, and you know, you got to remember, this was in 1970. And then a couple years later, a year and a half later or so, was when Baker had the big situation in Omaha, where he had supposedly, he was given credit for killing Alberto Torres after a match. He had, Torres had suffered I think it was a ruptured pancreas or something, had nothing to do with the match. But Joe Dusick, the promoter, wanted Baker to come out and brag along with his tag team partner at the time, who was the Claw, and it was Tom Andrews under a mask.
Tom Andrews, yeah.
And he wanted them to take credit for killing, because Torres had went to the hospital and he passed away. And I had a chance to talk with Ramon Torres, Alberto's brother, and later on a couple of times. And he said that that was the most horrific thing he'd ever seen a promoter want to promote, that you had actually killed a man and that you're happy about it. And then later on, you know, Baker, he made a career of carrying the stretcher into the ring with the carryout service written on it. I don't know if you guys ever recall those clips, but this is what he did. And then he also took credit for, killing Ray Gunkel in 1972 in Atlanta. He was in a match with Gunkel, and supposedly the heart punch had went in, and Gunkel, I don't know, the story goes that he had eaten a full meal right before the match, and definitely, I'm sure he had some heart issues or something, and he died. And Baker got credit for that, and he boasted about it. So despite my fun story about Baker in the locker room, I didn't really have a lot of respect for him because I always felt, even as a younger kid, that was just kind of carrying it too far. And Tom Andrews, the Claw, he almost, I was at one of the Hall of Fames one time talking with him, and he almost broke down. He said, when Dusick wanted us to promote that, he said, that's when I said, I'm done. He almost quit the business. He said it was over the top for him. But we know he went on to become one of the masked interns and had a great career. But yeah, Baker was an interesting guy.
I did hear about the Ray Gunkel story, George. So
yeah, and of course that started the whole Atlanta debacle there in 72 when Ann Gunkel was taking over the promotion. And, you know, Tom, you remember the big split they had down there? That was like one of the
Gentlemen, and, I have to exit out. My tree guy is here.
Oh, so yeah, take care of that, Tom. No problem, buddy.
I thank you very much for having me on, and hope to do it again in the future. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, absolutely, have Tom. We'll reconnect soon. Yes, sir. Thanks for joining us. Hey, when the tree guy shows up, you got to go, man. That's how it goes. Yeah.
Tom didn't tell you he's going to just go out and climb the tree with one of his fellow friends.
He's going to chop it down with his hand right now is what he's doing.
Tom is a great guy, you guys. He doesn't. He's one of the quieter historians. He doesn't give him credit for being a historian, but he's one of the quieter guys. But I'd put gospel on most everything he says. And like I said,
to get him back and get some more stories out of him for sure.
Yeah. And him and I, we've known each other, boy, about 55 years. So.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, definitely. Well, Charlie, we have a jobber of the week here.
Yes, sir. Let's roll right into it, guys. Our enhancement talent, our jobber of the week. And we have that ready there, John. There he is. Mr. W.T. Jones is our jobber of the week, or Wilt Jones, if you will. He was 0-16 during his career, wrestled from 1989 to 1993. I was watching this squash match that he had with, I don't know if you guys remember Max Moon in the WWF.
That was
kind of a terrible.
Wasn't that the character of the Paul Diamond character?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I wasn't even sure on that because I remember him. But
Paul Diamond, the fake Paul Diamond.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. So. Max Moon pretty much dominated this match. You know, the funny thing is, I always get a kick out of whenever Monsoon and Heenan are on commentary, and they were for this match. And the chemistry, as you guys know, between those two guys, maybe besides JR and King, was just unmatched. But Gorilla Monsoon during the match, he goes, "Hey, Bob," he goes, "Brain, what do you think the WT stands for?" He goes, "Wasting his time." It's, you know, with that quick wit, Bobby Heenan, wasting his time. Is what that stands for. And pretty much Max Moon made quick work out of him. But Max Moon, you know, you could almost say he was a little bit of a jobber himself. He didn't have much of a career with that gimmick. But again, shout out to W.T. Jones, Wilt Jones, who wrestled for 4 years and an 0-16 record, doing the grunt work as our enhancement talent, our jobber of the week. So shout out to W.T. there. And it's not standing for wasting his time. It was Wilt something or other. So.
Yeah, well, Charlie, why don't you tell our viewers out there, we have a special show next Saturday morning with a great guest.
You got to know the schedule better than I do. I believe it's Ricky we have next week, correct?
Yes, that's right. The Rock's uncle. That's right.
The Rock's uncle, the Dwayne Johnson, of course. So we have Ricky Johnson. If you smell what the Rick is cooking, if you will. We're going to be finding out next week because I'm sure he's going to have some great stories about The Rock. I would hope so. You know, and of course, and his father as well. So that should be very, very interesting. So hope you guys join us. And we had a comment there, John, from Facebook. We were getting some love there. We appreciate you there. It was Mark Swimmer. Appreciate you, Mark, for giving us some love there. Right back at you, buddy. Appreciate that. So, gentlemen, yeah, another great show, man. Great stories. Shame Tom had to leave us a little early, but you know, Todd and George, thanks for joining us once again, guys. We always appreciate the stories. The background of some of these guys that we didn't know about, or at least I didn't know about. It's always interesting, man. Appreciate you guys.
Really, it's great to always to be on. Todd, nice to meet with you. I'm sure we'll hook up down the road somewhere. John Restano, thank you, sir. Bless you. bless you for guiding the boat down the water each week.
That's right.
Charlie, and shout out to Charlie, you're the man of the hour. Too sweet to be sour. And DiCarlo, I don't know. You're just DiCarlo.
That's right. His video library speaks for itself. You know.
By the way, that video library, you showed the clip of Vashon and Stud from Minneapolis. I'm in the audience. If you look at it, I'm sitting ringside there in the
corner. Oh, no way.
Yeah. I had corner seats for a million years there. So
nice.
George,
what were you saying there, John?
Nice to meet you as well. And I can't give better descriptions of the three than you did. So, but thank you guys for having me back. I love talking wrestling, and I have a lot of good stories from mid 80s, early 80s through about 2000 that I love to share. So thank you for letting me do that.
Tom Burke Absolutely. And I have a lot of stories from the 80s and the mid 80s too, but they're 1800s.
I want to tell you guys the next time I see it, because you had mentioned Bobby Heenan. You know, my dad in his wallet had a card. You know, you didn't have a cell phone. He had a card where he had some of the wrestlers' phone numbers on there. And I think, Charlie, you may get a kick out of this. Kind of goes with, so we'll end the show. You started the show with kind of a prank, and I guess I'll end it with this story. So when my older brother, a couple years older than me, we're probably like 11, and my older brother and his friend, we went into my dad's wallet, and there's Bobby Heenan's phone number. Right on the time, this is right after when the Islanders stole Matilda from the British Bulldogs. You guys remember?
Oh yeah. So my
brother's friend puts together this fake British accent, British Bulldog, and Bobby Heenan's wife answers the phone, and he said, "But he stole Matilda," and she's like, "I don't know. We'll try to get him back." I mean, she was, but actually, it was, you know, my dad wouldn't have been too happy, but we were kids, and you got Bobby Heenan's number and a phone, and you're a kid.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I used to prank random people out of the phone book. You had access to Bobby Heenan and pro, and that's pretty awesome, man. I'm jealous of that.
The other one I remember was Mr. Fuji. Real quick, we called him, and it went to voicemail, and he sounded like Mr. Smith, not Mr. Fuji, I can tell you. But thanks for having me on. I really appreciate it. It's fun. I got a lot more to tell.
Oh, we'll definitely have you back, Todd, if you're willing. And thanks again for joining us, man.
Love to. Thank you, guys.
Definitely. John, do we have a statement of the week here?
Yes, we do. Give me 1 second. It'll be a quick, I think. Where is it at? Well, you know what? I'll just say it. 988 is the suicide prevention number. Give that a call 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I thought I had a video, but we don't need it. You know what it is, 988. If you have a problem and it feels like it's like you're at the end of the rope, call there, please, because there's people there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week that do this professionally. We know someone from another podcast that confided in us and said they were there and they called, and they people stay on the phone for 5 hours throughout the night, made them feel, and everything else, the guy's good now. So 988 is the number to call.
Yeah, it's important information, John, and appreciate it real quick, because it's actually mental health awareness month, the month of May. And this was brought to my attention from somebody that I work with, because we do a similar thing where somebody will bring up something that they have a cause or whatever the case. They brought up mental health month being this month, so that important information there, John. Thank you so much for that. But anyway, go ahead there, Chris.
Yeah, we would like to shout out, our thoughts and prayers are with our executive producer behind the scenes there that shares the show all over, John's lovely wife, Robin, and check out their Facebook pages about her GoFundMe. So we think about her.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, guys, I guess we're going to go ahead and wrap up here. And George, we don't want to slight you either, man. We want to thank you again for you know, joining us as you do, as much as you do, and sharing your wrestling knowledge and stories that go with these clips. It's just priceless for us, man. We appreciate you guys.
I just make everything up as I go along.
Hey, it works for us, man.
That's not true. Thank you, guys. Love you all. Thanks.
Take care, man. Take care, Todd. All right, gentlemen, as we wrap up here, again, man, guys, it's almost like June. Like, what the hell's going on? But we're loving the weather here in Western New York for sure. One thing about this area, we get our balls busted about the snow here, but the summers here are pretty nice weather-wise. We were usually like in the 70s or 80s, and we're enjoying that shit. So enjoy that, guys. Next weekend is Memorial Day weekend, so we got the long weekend ahead of us. And we'll be sure to give them their proper respect as we do next week's show. Again, with Ricky Johnson, as we smell what the Rick is cooking next week, and we're going to get that rolling.
All right, man.
Thank you.
All right. Anything else, guys? We all good?
We're good.
All right. Have a good weekend, guys.